Jewish Education and Media is pleased to present L'Chaim, a program that highlights the people, issues, and events of importance to the Jewish community. Now here is your host, Rabbi Mark Golub.
I'm Mark Golub. Welcome to the second special roundtable edition of L'Chaim, where I'm honored to be joined by a most thoughtful, wonderful panel to discuss some of the sensitive issues facing Jewish life today, American life today. I am a fan of each one of them. Let me reintroduce them to you. Mort Klein is national president of the ZOA, the Zionist Organization of America. And of course, Mort Klein is an outspoken gadfly who brings passion and demands honesty on a host of issues he believes are being handled poorly by the Jewish establishment. Have I said it correctly, Mort?
Not strong enough.
Not strong enough. Okay. J.J. Goldberg is one of American Jewry's foremost journalists and columnists. He's editor-at-large of the Jewish weekly newspaper, The Forward, where he served as editor-in-chief for 7 years, an outspoken individual also, and one who brings passion to everything he discusses. We're also joined again by one of Israel's most articulate spokesperson, a man who spent much of his adult life in the halls of Israeli diplomacy, Ambassador Danny Ayalon, who served as Israel's U.S. ambassador from 2002 to 2006. He's also a former deputy foreign minister for the State of Israel. And as I said before, you can see Danny's wonderful video series, The Truth About Israel, here on JBS all the time. You're coming out with a new one, right?
Yes, Truth About Jerusalem, and you will be premiering it.
Right here on JBS. As always, I sit next to one of American Jewry's most talented essayists, novelists, a fabulous advocate for the State of Israel, Thane Rosenbaum, distinguished fellow at NYU Law School, director of the Forum on Law, Culture, and Society, and the author of How Sweet It Is, one of many of the novels he's written. How Sweet It Is a story of life in Miami Beach in the watershed year of 1972. Cassius Clay and Jackie Gleason.
Frank Sinatra. Muhammad Ali.
A fabulous
Fidel novel. Castro.
All of them.
They're all in the
novel. Your book. Very, very good. And it is so wonderful to have you once again sitting with me. Thank you very, very much. You know, I have two interests that I want to just throw around here. I want to begin with Trump. And I want to hear what all of you feel about the new president of the United States. And I know, look, you're an Israeli. So if you talk about Trump, I'm not going to ask you to speak as an American. I'd love you to say anything you could from an Israeli perspective. We'll talk about Trump, and then I want to talk about a couple other issues as well. And at the end of our last meeting, I had to interrupt you because of the clock. I'm going to begin with you. What bothers you about Donald Trump that you were trying to express? It seemed to relate to the issue of Israel, but it was a larger issue. Try to explain it to us.
Well, I want to start by saying my feelings and what bothers me don't interest me very much. I like to report what other people are saying, and I want to know what influences events. My observation is that Trump doesn't have much of a background in foreign policy, doesn't understand the diplomatic implications of, for example, insulting somebody on television and then expecting to be able to work with them the next day. You can do that in New York real estate. You can't do that on the world stage. He doesn't get that. He appointed David Friedman, who is a major funder of the settlement movement, as his ambassador to Israel, and Rex Tillerson, who was from the oil industry, as the Secretary of State, and James Mattis, who takes the military, American military view. He's the defense secretary, and has said publicly that Israel, he believes, is on its way to an apartheid state. He's associated with people who have said that settlements anger Arabs throughout the Arab world and endanger American lives. So he's created within his administration two polar opposite wings on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And if he's done that on purpose, kol hakavod, good work. But I don't think so. I think he did it by accident, not realizing what he was doing. Every president who's come in, going back at least to Clinton and I think earlier, has said during the campaign, I'm going to move the embassy to Jerusalem, and then didn't. Trump did exactly the same thing, and he's getting attacked for it. People expected him, unlike Bush or Clinton, to do what he said he was going to do, when he's actually, if you look at his record, the last person you should expect to do what he said he's going to do, because he doesn't feel particularly bound by what he says. The next day, he could either deny he said it, or reinterpret it, or attack people for quoting him.
What do you have to say?
Well, first of all, I disagree. I think Trump...
People are upset that Trump is actually doing most of what he promised. He's reducing the onerous regulations on businesses. he is making an attempt to keep America safe by trying to not allow immigrants from countries which have had a history of Islamic terrorism, or terrorism, I should really say, to this country. He understands, he said that these people cannot be vetted, as the head of the FBI said, as the head of National Intelligence, Clapper, said, as the head of Homeland Security, Peter King, said, they can't be vetted. He wants extreme vetting. So he's really moving in the direction of fulfilling his promises. On the Israeli issue, I think one of the problems he's had is he's not getting support from the Jewish organizations and even the administration, frankly, in Israel, about moving the embassy and publicly saying we have every right to live
Why
in Judea
is that?
And Samaria. Well, American Jews, of course, are quite liberal politically, and because of 2,000 years, in my view, of persecution against our people, Jewish people, hatred, pogroms, Holocaust, a big chunk of the American Jewish people throughout the world, are so afraid of the non-Jew who've done so much harm to us that we're desperate to reach out to those who hate us and want to harm us by trying to appease them. I believe Jews want to appease the Muslims because of their enmity toward us and because they commit terrorism against Jews and others. And I think that they're worried about upsetting the Muslims in the Middle East by building homes in Judea and Samaria, by moving the embassy, by not creating a state now, which of course will be a Hamas terrorism state. We haven't mentioned that Hamas is allied with Fatah. And I think that that's why you have these Jewish groups, even though the Israeli government has asked them to support some of these things. AIPAC, for example, doesn't tell the truth. They say, we do whatever Israel wants. Israel has asked them to support the right of Jews to live in Judea and Samaria. They have refused to do it. They lobby for aid to the Palestinians. They support a state. And they supported the Gaza withdrawal and such.
They supported the withdrawal from Gaza.
They supported the forcible evacuation of Jews from Gaza. AIPAC did.
Which was an Israeli move.
It was an Israeli move. Now we see that was a terrible mistake.
Yes, but and by the way, you always said it was going to be a mistake. But be that as it may, that's an example of AIPAC doing what Israel wanted.
Yes, but sometimes when it goes along with their liberal inclinations, they will do it. When it doesn't, like supporting the right of Jews to live in Judea and Samaria, they won't do it.
You think AIPAC is a liberal-oriented group?
I know that AIPAC is a liberal-oriented
group. You
know
that the general feeling in the American Jewish community is AIPAC is too far right.
It's too far right if you support a Palestinian state as they do, if they lobby for aid for the Palestinians as they do, if they do not say they support the right of Jews to live in Judea and Samaria, if they've called Arafat at the time a moderate peace seeker and Abbas a moderate peace seeker. That's right wing? I don't think so. This is simply an erroneous impression that AIPAC has given, permeates and promotes, which is false, just like the impression that we are strongly right-wing.
You're not
strongly
right-wing.
No, we just tell the truth about the Arab-Islamic war against Israel. We're the ones who said Oslo will lead to disaster. Arafat is still a terrorist. I've testified next to Howard Kaur about Arafat and others, saying that Arafat is not a peacemaker. The Gaza withdrawal will lead to Hamas rockets. So how is that right-wing simply telling the truth? Winston Churchill telling the truth about the Germans in the late 30s was not a right-wing warmonger, as he was labeled. He was simply telling the truth. Truth is not a political position. Every Jewish group except ZOA is left-wing, virtually every group, and they're interested in appeasing the Palestinian Authority and the Muslims out of fear, not out of principle, not out of liberal.
Fear.
In my opinion,
out of fear. You think American Jews are afraid?
They're afraid because of our history. They're afraid of those who have enmity toward us, those who commit violence and terrorism. Anti-Semitism is rising. They're afraid. And there's this feeling among so many Jews, let's just appease them. Let's give them a state. Let's offer them more. Let's scream about not building anywhere in Judea and Samaria, even though it's only 2% of all of Judea and Samaria in which Jewish communities exist. They feel this appeasement. Maybe they'll stop hating us. This is fear.
One more question. You hear all the time, there are many, maybe the overwhelming number of American Jews, they kill Trump. They think he is a racist, a bigot, a misogynist, Islamophobic, maybe even he's a white racist, a white supremacist. Some people say he's an anti-Semite. Everyone says that even if he's none of that, one thing is clear, he has no business being president because he doesn't know what he's doing. That's the Jewish, American Jewish view almost to a one. What do you say?
He actually got a larger percentage of the Jewish vote than previous presidents.
It doesn't matter. You know what I mean.
Look, to call a man who has changed the rules of his country club, Mar-a-Lago Country Club, which didn't allow blacks or Jews, and the first thing he did is demanded that Jews and blacks be allowed, racist or a bigot, is absurd. A man whose grandchildren are Orthodox Jews, whose daughter became an Orthodox Jew, which is far more than I can say for many of my friends' children and grandchildren, unfortunately, this is absurd. And the people he's picked around him are the most pro-Israel people, I believe, of any administration that I can remember. As advisors, Mike Huckabee and Newt Gingrich and Rudy Giuliani, Mike Pence, I know personally, he's a spectacular friend of Israel. David Friedman is an ardent Zionist who believes, shockingly, that Jews have a right to live in Judea. My God, that's certainly a radical view, and believes a Palestinian Arab state at this point will be a terrorist state, which of course it will be. We don't want another Gaza in Judea and Samaria in the West Bank. So all he's talked about are rational positions that any rational human being realizes. Israel's dealing with a Hamas Fatah, vicious terrorist parties who want to destroy Israel, and David Friedman has simply explained that. I'm so glad that he will be the ambassador, because previous ambassadors like Martin Indyk and Dan Kurtzer have just said, give them all the land, give them a state, give them half of Jerusalem, you'll get peace. They've offered all that Israel, and they haven't gotten peace, only terrorism.
You know, it's so interesting. There are
and by the way, let me, Steve Bannon, who's been condemned by ADL as an anti-Semite, until I came out and said, I know Steve Bannon, I know his writings, he's helped us with fighting campus anti-Semitism. He's helped us. His top three people he hired are yarmulke-wearing Jews. Anti-Semites do not like looking at Jews with yarmulkes on. You don't hire such people. ADL finally came out and said, the truth is, we don't know of any writings or statements he's made that are anti-Semitic.
Yes. By the way, just a footnote to what you're saying, Fareed Zakaria, who is obviously on the left and a major American journalist, has a program on CNN, he made an interesting point that he studied Steve Bannon, could find nothing that was either anti-Semitic or white supremacist in anything related to Steve Bannon. And then he had other criticisms of Steve Bannon, but he felt that the camp claim that Steve was either anti-Semitic or white supremacist had no bearing. There will be people who are watching L'Chaim right now who will say, you know, I don't know how you could have Mort Klein on. And I know there are people who will not sit with you because they are in some way threatened by you. The way it's expressed, Mort, is, well, you're too far on the right. And not only that, you would say anything. And you're too inflammatory. And you're not civil enough. And people who are inflammatory and not civil enough, they don't belong in all of my dealings. And you and I have now known each other a long, long time. And I've said to you over and over again, I find your position to be reasoned. I find you always to be thoughtful. You have turned out to be right much more often than not. You are also one of the loveliest human beings I know. And I resent the way in which you are characterized on the American Jewish scene. But you should know, and you probably do know, that many people just They just think you are representing the worst of the Jewish community.
Well, this is, of course, nonsense. If this were true, would the federations have me as one as being part of their Speaker's Bureau? Would the Israel Bonds have me being on their Speaker's Bureau? Would the Forward, JJ's newspaper, 13 times in the last 23 years, chosen me as one of the serious Jewish leaders in America, once number four in the top five? Would I be invited to speak at many Reform synagogues? Would I get standing ovations? I say unhumbly at virtually every speech I give at conservative and Reform synagogues. Because when the Jewish people hear the facts and the truth, they realize that this is an Arab-Islamic war against Israel. It's not the nonsense about the settlements or about the lack of statehood. In fact, Izzy Liebler, who you've interviewed many times, this very week said that ZOA is the only organization that's come out properly criticizing Jewish groups for taking the wrong positions, and now we have come out to be a major voice with extensive media coverage on the positions we take, because people now realize, painfully and tragically, the pessimistic things we've said have turned out to be true.
Well, I have no problem if there are Jews who watch JBS who disagree with you. Everybody has the right to disagree with you, but they can't dismiss you and they cannot vilify you, and what they have to do is offer, in my mind, valid counter arguments if they think you're wrong. Anything else is inappropriate from a Jewish perspective. You wanted to say?
There's too many people on the right and the left have a habit of condemning an individual
right
because of what they see. First of
thank
all,
you,
somebody
JJ
disagrees with me.
Yes.
I have very close friends who are settlers in the West Bank.
Yes.
I have relatives who live in Hebron.
Yes.
I love them and I visit them and we maintain these relationships and we learn from each other. And this happens on both sides.
Good
Bannon
for you.
Was for several years the chief executive of the Breitbart website, which published people who elsewhere had written things that were anti-Semitic or anti-black. Now, because he hired somebody on his website to write something when they had written something objectionable somewhere else, doesn't make him an anti-Semite. That's the basis of the accusation against him, that he publishes opinion from people whose other opinions we don't like.
Interesting, very interesting. You have any comment on this? Because you occupy a highly respected position in the Jewish community, and you do know that Mort is often vilified. What would you say to the JBS audience that thinks Mort Klein is just off the wall?
I love Mort Klein. Where's the camera? Ladies and gentlemen of JBS, I love Mort Klein.
Yes, but why?
Look, you hear him, you know, he's an incredibly passionate and articulate voice, and what you said is also true, and you've said this before on this show, Mort ends up being right more often than not, and I think that there is an American Jewish impulse to lean left, and left means to be more self-critical of us than the other side. That's what it means. The left's fixation on Tikkun Olam, all of this is based on a kind of self-reflection of what are we doing wrong. And I would say the thing that Mort does is that he highlights truth to a large degree. He's not responding to other things. You heard him say, obviously, Israel's going to have to make some concessions. Danny said that too, some concessions. But I think that largely he's addressing himself to truth. I think that the discussion that JJ and
please
I had in the earlier
yes
discussion was very helpful. And by the way, you're not going to get that on any other show. You have to come to JBS TV, where you heard JJ and Thane actually discussing not just Resolution 2334, but the San Remo Resolution and the Balfour Declaration and Resolution 2422 and what the Fortune Eva Convention even says. It's not on MSNBC, right? So that kind of clarification, this is what Mort is trying to do. If you just, when I spoke at Berkeley a few weeks ago,
tell us about that.
Well, when I spoke to Berkeley and I used the language title to property, title to land, because they're lawyers, they're young lawyers. And I just said, I took them through the law. I said, let's just make a legal argument that the settlements themselves, I mean, JJ's earlier point is absolutely correct. If you are fighting a defensive war against an aggressor, you have no obligation under international law to ever leave, ever, unless there is some agreement.
Did you say that at Berkeley?
Yes, absolutely.
Did they give you a round of
applause? Oh, they went nuts. They went nuts. Ever, never leave
until... Were people
until
protesting your presence there?
Oh, God, there were people holding out pamphlets as I walked in. Absolutely. And then the question and answer period was all hammering away. By the way, many of them were Jews. hammering away at this guy. But I simply wanted to calmly lay out the law, right? And I just said, look, you know, I don't think anyone has legal title to this area. It's not clear to me. First of all, the military occupation is completely appropriate because there's never been an agreement that allows Israel to withdraw in peace.
Of course.
Right? So then the question becomes, okay, if the military occupation, would Israel be in a different position if there had never been any settlements? That's probably true, which is why the idea of helpfulness.
I'm sorry, what do you mean?
Well, if there had never been any settlements and Israel had simply occupied the land, there wouldn't even be a question at all. It's clearly legal what they're doing because they have no reason to leave until they can leave in safety and in peace.
Then why does the American government tell them to leave? Why does the UN resolution in the Security Council say that every community on the east side of the Green Line, every community,
yeah,
that's Male Adumim.
Yeah, it's outrageous.
That's Efrat. That's the Etzion block.
Yeah, I know. It's
let alone Ariel. And by the way, I don't understand why Jews have no right to live on the West Bank.
Well, here's something else I said to the people at Berkeley, which no one wants to admit. You know, if we're all nuts about Trump because he doesn't want Muslims and there's the ban, whatever it is that we're upset about, right? If the people from Tennessee had said to the people from Kentucky, we don't want anybody from Kentucky ever living here, ever, not one person, we wouldn't be very sympathetic to the people from Tennessee. That's exactly what the Palestinian Authority is saying. The Palestinian Authority, what's liberal about that? Why would anyone get behind that? Why would someone at Berkeley think that's okay? 20% of Israel is made up of Arabs. Supreme Court justices on the Israeli Supreme Court are Arabs. Arabs are involved in every part of society. There's an Ethiopian Miss Israel from 2 years ago. It couldn't be more of a pluralistic society. Why, I'll ask you again, why would anyone be so passionate behind the Palestinian side for a country that, a purported country, that is going to say, and there cannot be Jews anywhere here? And the question is, why would, that's an illiberal position. It's an anti-democratic position. It's an anti-pluralistic position. But if you tell people this, like if you lay it out, right, which is sort of what Mort is doing, it's what I try
to do.
And
what you do, sure.
It's what I just lay.
Your whole series is this.
Yeah, to absolutely lay this thing out. And I think I honestly think, I don't know, JJ's view is, it generally tends to enrage Jewish leftists because at bottom, that part of the story is not the story that they're as interested in. At bottom, they're really interested in the self-reflection, the self-scrutiny of the Jewish people.
Okay.
Are we conducting ourselves?
Okay.
But can I just briefly just say something about the Trump story?
Or yes, absolutely.
Just quickly about Trump. You know, the Trump thing story is interesting to me because it's like most things. There's this good thing and then there's this horrible thing. Here's the good thing. I actually think that in his core, he's pro-Israel for all the reasons that he would be, for the reasons that we were talking here, the rational reason. I think he doesn't think that the settlements are a major obstacle to peace. I don't think he thinks that the Palestinians are ready for nation building. They haven't shown themselves to demonstrate that capacity for statesmanship. But so I think that in that way you have a pro-Israel president. But you also have a president we've seen now for a couple years on the world stage who is, he is in love with the adulation of the crowd.
Trump.
He needs the approval of his people.
And just so I understand, did Obama enjoy the adulation of the crowd?
Yes, absolutely. Look,
did he need it any less than Trump?
You know,
No. I want you can say yes.
I think
no.
He probably needed it less. Trump seems to be particularly.
Okay, and what if I said to you, the only difference is one is naked and one is clothed?
That may be true. But
you understand?
But that may be true. That everybody.
This drives me nuts. I know who these people are.
Right.
Every one of them couldn't do it.
You're saying to be a political figure.
You to be
this
president.
This is your DNA.
Clinton needed it. Hillary wanted
okay,
it.
It's a good point.
Obama needed it. Trump needs it. The only difference is Trump's naked, because he wasn't schooled. He didn't spend a lifetime getting ready with the niceties and the veneer. It's a veneer. They all have a veneer. I hate them all. All you have here is a guy who never thought he was going to be president. If a Hillary Clinton or a Marco Rubio, any one of them, lose, their life is over. If Trump lost, he'd go back to being a billionaire. It wasn't who he ever trained to be. So there's nothing here between him.
Okay.
And that's all. And I don't understand why Americans don't get it. By the way, maybe we don't like that in any president. I understand it. But to think that Trump is unique in that, there are other problems that I think. What you just said, and it's what JJ was hinting at, the real problem with Trump, and you've heard me now. You've been next to me. I've argued this for more than a year. Most of the criticism of Trump is garbage. I'm interested in policy. I'm interested in what really makes the difference between when he becomes president. My concern is we've elected somebody for very cogent reasons who is totally unqualified. I don't believe he knows anything about anything. I don't believe he understands the Middle East. I don't think he understands China. I don't think he understands Taiwan. I don't think he understands Korea. Nothing.
He understands who Frederick Douglass is.
He understands, right? He understands nothing. What he understands is, I believe, however, this guy is motivated because he thinks he can make a positive difference. And then he's picking people around him who he thinks is going to help him. And he has a managerial style. He is the classic CEO. I'm going to get people in all the right positions who know what they're doing. They're going to bring it to me, and I'm smart enough to make a decision. And ultimately, I do not believe a president is king or czar, and that every time he runs amok, the American people, the left, the Democratic Party, and people within his administration will pull him up short. But does it bother me that he's good in front of a crowd? Obama was the best in front of a crowd. Everybody said the thing about Obama that made him the best was when he went out of the White House. His policy couldn't do a thing. Put him in front of a crowd. He was the best orator we've heard in our lifetime, including JFK.
But
he was, by the way, the classic. I know this is going to shock. This is going to upset. He was. Obama was, and I take all of the moral valence out of it, he was a demagogue. He was not an evil demagogue. Demagogues are those who can get up in front of a large group and influence them. Some demagogues influences in one direction, other demagogues, but the notion, Trump's a demagogue and Obama wasn't, what are you watching? And I understand, most of us, we resonated with Obama and this idea we would have the first African-American president. And who the heck is Donald Trump? Who the heck is he to become president? He is not fit to be president. But you know what? He hit a nerve. There was a perfect storm. He's president. And it's time for the Jewish community to listen to the Alan Dershowitzes, who say, don't make an enemy out of the president. Watch what he does. Be vigilant. You criticize him when he's wrong. But don't say he's not your president. And don't march in the streets and say he. And don't go to Berkeley and smash windows and riot. And don't be part of Black Lives Matter for all the good it does. It is virulently anti-Israel, pro-Palestinian. And it's not pro-Palestinian in some generic way. It's pro-Palestinian. There should be no Jewish state.
Can I just clarify briefly the adulation of Trump? By the way, I agree with that last point, too. I think we should play this thing out. But what I meant about the adulation of Trump was I was troubled that he wasn't able to more clearly disavow David Duke. I think that at his core there is, I've said this on the show,
yes,
and
you
jump on me every
I
time
don't
I
jump
say
on you. I don't
no, but
jump
you
on
disagree
you.
With me.
I
each
disagree
time.
With you a little bit.
I feel that the Trump candidacy had normalized a kind of old school anti-Semitism that we have not seen here. The JCCs that are being threatened with attacks around the United States, we're seeing the kinds of old school anti-Semitism which we had not seen in this country for many, many years. And I worry, and I said this also on this show, that Jews historically have never done well with mobs. And what Trump has galvanized has been a mob in his own
I don't know.
And so I'm just concerned that if things go badly for Jews, that he could turn, because I'm not sure that he would be able to resist turning if he thought his core constituency became anti-Israel or anti-Jewish.
I think because the anti-Semites
in America see that they have a president who's so pro-Israel and pro-Jewish, who has an Orthodox Jewish child and grandchildren, I think this has incensed the anti-Semites to react and act out. So I think it's really, for in some sense, positive reasons that you're seeing this type of horrible anti-Semitic reaction that all of us
You've
oppose.
Been so lovely and patient.
Oh, it's most enlightening. I enjoy it, yes. Okay. I learn a lot out of this.
Okay, I don't know what's fair to ask you, but I'll just say to you, here you are an Israeli, and now that you've been in government. Do you have any comment on, from an Israeli perspective, what does it mean that Donald Trump became the president of the United States?
Well, first off, let me tell you, Israel should not ever be in this line of fire between Democrats and Republicans here. I think one of the secrets of this great alliance of ours...
Are they in fire? Oh, the last I saw it was the Democrats who were boycotting Benjamin Netanyahu.
Right.
Right now, I worry that if anybody is going to abandon Israel, it's those with whom I have been associated with my entire life, the Democratic Party. Now, it's the left wing. People say it's the far left. But it's bothering me that at the moment the Democratic Party, not the Republican Party, the Democratic Party seems to be distancing itself from Israel. How do you feel as an Israeli?
Very disconcerting. I see, and again, I don't want to make any comments about American politics,
yes.
So just maybe as an observer. But let's say if Keith Ellison is becoming the chair, if Bernie Sanders is the standard bearer, then we do have a problem. One of the secrets, this solid foundation of this great alliance, which I think is a natural alliance between Israel and the United States. It's a two-way street. Of course, we are the junior partner, but the United States also needs Israel for various reasons. We will have a show for that, dedicated for that. So certainly I don't want Israel to be here in between. My position has always been, and always when I was ambassador, you know, always people would take, you know, I was here during the 2004 election, W and John Kerry. So I was, you know, people take me aside. We will not tell. Who does Israel prefer? And I always said, you know, I said, the best president for Israel is the one who will be best for America.
Marvelous.
And it's your responsibility and it's your call to decide who it is. Because a strong America, both domestically and internationally, makes Israel stronger as well. When there is no daylight between our two countries, I think it is a deterrent to any terrorism.
So now we go back to when Obama comes in, his first comment to Malcolm Holmline is, there ought to be daylight.
And you see in retrospect what happened with the so-called Arab Spring. I mean, the real going up in flame, the entire Arab world. I think the policies of Obama, not just towards Israel, but towards Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Iran, you know, he really was ditching all the natural allies of the United States and really falling into, probably by, I wouldn't say by design, probably by default, but really promoting the worst enemies of the United States, especially with Iran, Muslim Brotherhood, you know, when he preferred them over Mubarak. And again, many mistakes vis-a-vis China, vis-a-vis Russia. You can look at it.
Syria?
Syria. Yeah, Syria is probably a glaring example, not adhering to the red line and everything like that. But when I look at Trump now, again, as an observer, try to be maybe even academically speaking, you know, without any emotions that all of you here as Americans, you have a vested interest here and you're entitled to speak emotionally about it, which is fine. I take a step back and I look at him, and again, I don't want to characterize him in any way or shape. I'm just looking at it again from the policies and from the practices and the objectives. So I look at Trump as a disruptor. And sometimes you need disruptors to make the world better. If you look at history, we have these guys that, you know, made a real change. certainly in Washington, and not just in Washington, political establishments all over the world. Take it in Europe. I'm not talking about non-democratic countries, even in Israel. Political establishments today are ineffective, are weak, corrupt in many ways, in many respects. So, and again, there's hands washing hands, you know, scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. I think by him coming from the outside, he has a chance to make it much, much better. And for the long term, I think that there is a healthy instinct, you know, in the multitudes. The fact that he did strike a chord, the fact that he, as he said, he created a movement. He ran against Republicans. He ran against Democrats. He ran against existing politicians, and he won. So certainly he has the right to feel that he has the mandate. And I'm not being confused by the fact, again, I know very well the American system, that yes, Hillary won 2-point-something million more votes. But democratically, he won almost in a landslide. So certainly he has a mandate. So for anyone to say he is not my president, this is undemocratic. So, and it's certainly not becoming the liberals, you know, who would have been furious of any, let's say, attempt to delegitimize Hillary had she won, doing the same thing and really stooping down to the, I would say, the lowest standards, which are really not becoming any democratic nation. Now, being a disruptor, I think he does have a chance not only to change America domestically, again, from many, many problems you have here. I think the economy, he can make a strong economy. And also, which is very important worldwide and for Israel, to reestablish American leadership and deterrence. I think Obama pretty much eroded.
Okay. You know, there are many American Jews who would say to you, "He, if he changes things, he's going to change things for the worse."
Give him the benefit of the doubt.
That America is now in greater danger, that he is, because he is both unpredictable, unstable, you have no idea where he's going to be yesterday, today, or tomorrow, especially because he does not really come with any experience or background, that he might even not know how to handle North Korea. And, you know, I was hoping to hear what the four of you would say about the fact that we've always talked about the nuclear threat of an Iran getting a nuclear weapon. But we have in North Korea now, it seems to me, a lunatic who already has nuclear weapons. And what does that portend for the world? That's not simply America. And by the way, American Jews, because it's not, because, you know, North Korea doesn't single out Israel, does that make it less of a Jewish issue for Israelis or Americans? When you come and say to us, the very first thing on Netanyahu's agenda is going to be Iran because of the nuclear potential in Iran, I'm thinking to myself, what are American Jews and Americans in general, and what are Israelis thinking about the fact that there is a country now that is doing all kinds of ballistic tests and they have nuclear weapons? Does any Israeli worry about that? Or because, you know, North Korea doesn't saber rattle about Israel, is it a non-issue? But people are saying, you know what, the problem is, what if, you know, North Korea tests Donald Trump? Does he have any clue how to handle that? And are there American Jews who are really worried? Not, you know, forget climate change, which for American Jews is a big issue. And he doesn't seem to think there is such a thing as climate change of any seriousness. So people tell me, you know, we're going to destroy the world because of Donald Trump, because he's not going to do anything on climate change. But what about if there is a nuclear threat? And so that what I hear American Jews saying to me all the time is, we relate to somebody who doesn't know what he's doing. He is unstable emotionally. And heaven forbid what will happen. You talk about change. Yes, there'll be change. But you're suggesting a change could be for the better. How do we know, Denny, that the change won't be for the worse?
Okay.
By the way, I'm not giving my opinion here. I'm expressing what I hear all the time.
So I think I have some answers. Of course, nobody can predict the future.
And they want to hear what you have to say about this.
Yeah. So I'll tell you, first of all, let's take just specifically the issue of North Korea.
Yeah, please.
Totally different case than Iran.
Explain
you
why.
You cannot compare apples to oranges. I'll
Explain
tell you why.
Why.
North Korea, their motivation is economic. The only reason they have developed a nuclear infrastructure is to extort and get economic benefits. Now,
you don't worry they have any designs on destroying America or China
absolutely
or Israel.
No, they have nothing to feed their people with. Absolutely not. Also, they have this huge neighbor of theirs, China, which certainly China is the one who puts or keeps North Korea in check. And this is diplomacy. And here, I think Trump will have to actually negotiate with China on that as well. But there is one very strong relationship between North Korea and China. You know what it is? And Iran. That the Iranian deal, right, the Vienna agreement, which was, by the way, managed by the same people who managed the North Korean deal back in the 90s. And it's along the same lines. And the North Korea deal, we know, after a few years, boom, they detonate. So, and Iran has much more capabilities. Again, North Korea is for economic reasons. Iran is for political reasons, for hegemony, for being able to increase their terrorism with impunity. Totally different thing. And the scope is different. The Iranian, you know, the number of centrifuges, the number of all the elements are hundreds of times bigger than in North Korea. So this is the big difference. How will Trump deal with all this? I think he has probably so far a fairly good team. Whether he will listen to them or not, it's a big question. The fact that, and again, I think JJ referred to it, whether it's by design or default, that he picked some people with actually opposing views, I think it's a good thing. I think it's a good thing because a leader must need to hear both sides and then make a clear decision mm-hmm. based on the facts, based on his conscience, based on his direction. And
it
all
sounds you're optimistic.
I am optimistic, absolutely.
And Mort, it sounds like you're optimistic.
Yes.
Are you optimistic?
Not about Iran.
About Trump. I want a yes or no.
Yes.
Are you optimistic?
You know, there's an old saying, are you optimistic? Well, I'm optimistic in the sense that I'm hopeful that things will get better. I'm pessimistic in the sense that I fear my optimism is ill-founded. No, I'm not optimistic about Trump.
Okay. You've heard some of the things Danny has said. Any response to them?
There's been so many things that have been said. I hardly know where to begin. I want to make one point.
He talked about change. He said the nice thing about Trump is he may change things. Is there any resonance for you in that?
There needs to be change. Yes, there needs to be change. Change cannot be radical because it upsets the ground that we stand on. You need to know how things work and what leads to what. So when you trash mouth Mexico and China, you're going to have a bad result. Going to China to say rein in North Korea after you said China is ruining our economy is difficult. And the fact that he backtracks so quickly on these things and apologizes, it leaves not only hurt feelings, but mistrust that he didn't know what he was doing in the first place.
Can I offer one second, JJ, what if he is setting with all this rhetoric the bar very high? Maybe he's a good negotiator, so he wants to negotiate from a position of power, then it gives him leeway to come down and get something out of it from the other side.
It's possible. Maybe my pessimism is ill-founded.
Okay.
However, the thing that frightens me the most, the thing that he said that most scared me, was that Khizr Khan, the father of the fallen soldier, has no right to criticize me. He doesn't know me. You're in a presidential campaign. Of course he has a right to criticize you. Then he wants to loosen the libel laws, open up the libel laws, I think he said, because newspapers are too free to say unpleasant things. He's all through his campaign, he talked about who he approved of and who he didn't approve of, and it was almost entirely who says nice things about him and who says mean things. So the idea that everybody seeks adulation and you don't go into the presidency, it's one thing to seek adulation and to feed off the cheers of a crowd. It's another thing to have that be the basis of your policies, to not recognize your need for adulation as being a problem. He gets furious. As a demagogue, I've never seen a presidential candidate before talk about beating up people in the audience because they were yelling. Never seen it. Take him out of here in a stretcher. Send him to the hospital. That's unprecedented. We've never had a serious candidate who did things like that. And he claims, and then he, the following day, a week after, a month after, will deny he said anything. He's been denying things he said that were in transcripts and on tape. I don't think he knows when he's saying what's true and what's not true. I am very worried. Now, the left has been going out and demonstrating he's going to make abortions illegal. He's going to close the borders to Muslims. Those are issues in our political debate. Once you accept democracy, you accept the idea that the other side might win, and that makes them legitimate. However, the problem with Trump is not that he's a Republican and advocates policies the Republicans advocate. The problem is that he can't take criticism, that he loses something when he's criticized. The fact that he was running a presidential campaign, which besides talking about who's nice to him and who's not, Crooked Hillary, Little Marco, Lion Ted, this is not the way you run a political, this is not how you demonstrate that you're capable of being presidential. And after having built a career on that kind of language, to then object when somebody else calls you a name and passionately object. It's not like he's using that as a tactic. He feels. He goes off track. There's so many leaks coming out of the White House. The reporters in Washington say they've never seen a White House that was so leaky, with people trading secrets to the press about people who can't get along, people who can't work together, stupid things that are being done. The people that are close to him find him a little scary. And all of the Republicans who came out against him, not because of his policies, but because of who and what he was. So I'm worried. I am pessimistic. The only thing that makes me optimistic is that I see the Republicans in Congress beginning to peel away from him. I am hoping that at some point, either under the Emoluments Clause, I mean, he's taking to the television to use the presidential bully pulpit to threaten a department store that stopped carrying his daughter's jewelry. What kind of president does that? He doesn't have
which
any legal obligations.
Which president had a daughter with a jewelry line?
Exactly. Which president went into office without divesting?
What's the precedent here?
Well, there
the
is precedent an
precedent.
Is every,
which one?
No, not a jewelry line, but there is a precedent that no one picked up on. The Harry Truman with his daughter.
With his daughter, right.
Yeah, there is a precedent that he was told that it was incredibly unprecedential to threaten a reporter.
There's a larger one, Mark, which is that presidents before have divested themselves of their businesses so that nobody would suspect that a decision they were making was based on their own personal financial benefit. They divest. He doesn't even show us his tax returns, which would tell us where he's invested. We don't know where he's invested. We do know that the seven Arab countries, or seven Muslim countries, from which he banned immigration at this point, include a neat list of countries that have not sent any terrorists to us, but exclude countries which have, but where he has major public investments, hotels.
72 terrorists since 9/11 who have committed terrorism in America from those countries. That's one of the fake stories that have been out there.
And also, he used Obama's list.
Right.
I don't understand that. I don't understand why anybody would criticize him for that.
And the vast majority of Muslims are off that list around the world. They're not on the list.
Yeah.
I'm not objecting to who's on his list. I'm objecting to who's off his list and the suspicion that it may be because he owns property.
They were off Obama's list.
Obama's list was about a specific thing.
No, Obama's list was there were seven countries which are countries of concern. So he started there. By the way, how do you feel about the ban?
The ban?
Yeah.
As so many other things, I don't have feelings about it.
How do you feel about the ban?
We fervently supported.
How do you feel about the ban?
I think the president has the right to, under the Supremacy Clause of the Constitution, to protect his country if he thinks that
you're
it's under...
You're a professor of law. Isn't that obvious?
Yes, that's why I'm saying. I think the whole idea... And by the way, President Obama did the same thing. When he came into office, he did the same thing.
But it's also
there were restrictions early on, restrictions of certain countries, restrictions...
Iraq, absolutely.
And it's essentially his primary task as president.
So why is the left giving him so much grief over this?
Well, because the left's position is about inclusiveness, and this is about exclusiveness.
The
you know,
left wants more Democrats to come.
The left feels that liberal positions require that this country remain open and that we expose ourselves to the risks that even our Constitution presents in order to show how open and pluralistic society. But I have pointed out to students.
I don't mind that argument.
Yeah, but let me tell you, there's a great argument about that.
I just mind the argument that what he did was unconstitutional.
Right, but you know, the Supreme Court, Justice Jackson, and years later, Justice Goldberg, there's a very famous quote from one of those cases, I can't remember. Justice Robert Jackson said that the Constitution is not a suicide pact, which is a great line. It essentially says, we don't wrap ourselves in this Constitution if it means that it's going to be the end of our country. It's not intended to be set up that way. That's not what the Founding Fathers wanted or would have expected of us.
What president before him has gotten up and said the court has no right to restrain his behavior? It's essential to our constitutional system that the courts have the right.
Obama
presidents have said, I don't like that decision.
Obama
condemned the Supreme Court justices who were sitting right in front of him on the Citizens United Act, saying how wrong it was.
He said the decision was wrong. Trump didn't say the decision was wrong. Trump said they're so-called judges. That's the difference.
No, that's the line.
Trump
it's
said
personal.
The law is clear. I'm allowed to decide on a security basis to have a certain any class of aliens that we think are dangerous to America to not have them here. It's
he
a U.S. code.
That.
It's a U.S. code. And he said, you know, what right do you have to go against that U.S. code?
Well, they have a right to make decisions. He can disagree with the decisions.
That's all he
it's
meant.
One
but
thing.
That's all he meant.
So-called
you know,
judges, they have
all,
no right.
That's
I think this goes back
meant.
To the more point that Mark meant earlier. There is an incredible level of unsophistication that comes out
that's
of this
right.
administration that, and I'm not defending anyone. I'm just saying that it's so clear.
Yep. The line that resonates with me is that the media took him literally, not seriously, and the American people took him seriously, but not literally. And
we're not holding, we didn't, look, if you're saying the press holds Trump accountable for every word he says.
In a way, they hold nothing else.
Yeah, that's clear. But we saw that during the election,
that is
right, during the campaign, he was being held.
All right. So I asked you about the travel ban. What about borders? Do you think America should have open borders, or does America have a right to have some kind of border legalization?
Of course, there ought to have a right.
Is it of course? To
yeah.
You?
I mean, I was at a dinner party a few weeks ago, so I can't refer the name of the hostess. But she said to me, and I was shocked, she said, I don't believe there should be any restrictions.
Yes.
Anybody who wants to come to the United States, no matter what reason, and I thought, boy, here's a country that would shut down in an hour.
What right? do you think? Borders or no borders?
Absolutely. Every country has a right to decide who comes in. And the United States has a serious problem on its Mexican border, which is that it's too porous.
Right.
That's different from coming up with a silly idea like Mexico is going to buy us a big high wall. That's silly.
Is the silly part that Mexico is going to buy it, or is the silly part there will be a wall?
I have heard arguments that it's impossible to build a wall
that
there's terrain.
Does the wall offend you? You may say it's silly. There's definitely something just nonsense, or it offends me morally. Does the wall offend you morally?
No.
Okay. Well, does the wall offend you morally?
Of course not. You. We should keep out Nazis. Black haters from South Africa and those who will commit terrorism,
but
we should keep them out.
But Danny's the best person to talk to about this because the Israelis built a security fence and they remember what life was like before they built a security defense. So
it was very effective, hence it is very moral, it saves lives.
Is there any reason why Americans should be offended by a president saying we're going to build a wall along the border with Mexico?
I don't think so. I don't think that anyone, this lady that you mentioned, that said anyone can come to America, would she agree to bring anybody to her home without permission? It's the same thing.
Probably
it's
not.
The same thing.
But you did believe that everyone should come to America.
But here's what I've heard now everyone say. They're not against the wall. They may think it's stupid. They may think it's silly. but it's not morally offensive. And that the ban on seven Muslim nations, maybe not large enough, but it doesn't offend you morally. No. It doesn't offend you morally. Doesn't offend you morally. Doesn't offend you morally. Okay. Interesting for our audience to see this. I have one more topic I want to discuss with you before my time is up with you, although I never want to let you go. It comes out of the foreword. It was in your most recent edition in which it says, and I'm going to paraphrase, the Jewish establishment has failed in the BDS movement. Leadership, Jewish in America and Israel, is being castigated for having failed to rein in the BDS movement, specifically on college campuses. By the way, the day before we're taping this, I go to Columbia. There's a rally put on by SSI, Students Supporting Israel. And they invite UN Ambassador Danny Danone to speak to Columbia students. Columbia, SSI applies to Columbia for the right to open it up to the public. They're given 75 seats that they can sell to people coming in off the street.
Many of whom are alumni.
Many of whom are
alumni. So they should be invited.
Exactly right. The Saturday before, they get a call, only 10 will now be allowed in. All the rest must be called and told them they're no longer invited. I go because I want to see what's going on here. Danny Danone comes. He is remarkably courageous. There are, I would say, 7 to 10 pockets, and we're going to show this on JBS, 7 to 10 pockets of students who are there representing a Palestinian perspective. And at coordinated moments, roughly 2.5 minutes apart, groups stand up, maybe 5 or 6, and they start chanting, "From the river to the sea, Palestine will be free." And to the credit of the crowd is overwhelmingly pro-Israel. They hold up their own signs when that happens. A security person comes, no trouble. They escort them out, and Danny Danone continues to proceed. And then Danny says, and I say he's courageous. He says to the, I see there are some other groups here. You're about to stand up. I ask you, please stay. Stay and ask me questions. Debate with me.
Please stay for the Q&A. I want to listen to you. I want to listen to your questions. I want to answer them. I want to engage with you. Maybe you will convince me. So please, I don't know. I see a group here, maybe another one up there. So decide, at least leave one group here. I promise to finish in 10 minutes. I will finish my speech. I want to hear your questions, and I want to debate with you.
Stay. None of them stay. Each group gets up and leaves. And I interview Columbia students wearing yarmulkes before the event. And their position is the following. It's all Netanyahu's fault. Netanyahu has not made concessions. Netanyahu is the reason why there's no peace between Israel and Palestinians. And I'm here to challenge Danny Danone for saying in the New York Times that he wants to annex the West Bank and not give voting privileges to the Palestinians. And this kid does, in the question and answer period, get up and say to the ambassador to the United Nations for the State of Israel, in a New York Times piece, you said that the settlements ringing Jerusalem, not the West Bank, should be annexed by the State of Israel and there should be no voting rights for Palestinians. And Danone says, I don't remember really saying that. Well, here you said it on such and such a date in the New York Times in an op-ed piece you wrote. The mood in the room was ugly. It wasn't ugly only because there were Palestinian sympathizers there, I understood. I was disappointed in the quality of the Columbia student who came in there angry at Israel. And by the way, you can think Israel is wrong in certain ways, but how do you not at the same time say what you say? How is it, how can a Columbia student support a group who says, nobody can remain in our, not a Jew can remain in my state? How do you support people who have honor killings, throw homosexuals off of roofs?
Torch and, them first, though.
And how? And I'm saying to myself, these are bright kids. And this is whom we have been unable so far to figure out how to stop this movement. And it's something you have been in the forefront of from the Israeli position. But the Forward takes the big story. The Jewish establishment has failed. Has the Jewish establishment failed?
We have stopped almost every BDS vote from passing. Almost all of them have failed.
You have.
We and
the
others.
Jewish community.
Okay.
Community
has, so you feel the Forward is overstating the problem.
Yes, plus also, when you're dealing with college kids, George Bernard Shaw, whoever really said it, you know, when you're young and you have, and you're not left wing, you have no heart. When you're old, if you're not right wing, you have no brains. When you're young and idealistic, you know, you feel, take certain positions that really are not rational, don't make sense, thinking this is a way to make the world a better place. It's hard to convince young idealistic kids of the falseness of the image that the Palestinian Arabs have been oppressed. It's hard to convince them of that. But we have stopped, the establishment has stopped almost every vote from passing on BDS, and even a couple times when it passed, the president of that university has come out and saying, we're not going to fulfill what you want, because that's not who we are.
So should we not worry about BDS?
No, we have to worry about it, especially now with the UN resolution Obama refused to veto, and you know, the most hostile president is what we've ever had, a man who's released hundreds of terrorists from prison and given Iran a pathway to nukes. What I'm saying is, you know, you said this man doesn't have sinister motives. When he's done these things, I worry about his real motives.
You're talking about Obama.
Obama. But the UN resolution says that we have to treat all the area past the 67 line differently from Israel, openly really supporting BDS. That's part of the danger of this resolution. That's why we support the UN legislation by Cruz and Lindsey Graham to defund all of the UN, and the U.S. provides 22% of the monies of the UN until they rescind this anti-Semitic resolution. Because BDS, although they're failing in the universities, they're having some impact, practically speaking, in Judea and Samaria, almost none in Israel proper, and it could have a greater impact in Israel. We have to be worried about it.
Your attitude towards BDS, your comment, is it something that you worry about? Is it overblown in the Jewish community?
Netanyahu and people around him have said publicly, our economy is thriving, they haven't had an impact, but they want us to go to war on the issue that isn't hurting Israel. They need us to be upset about something. Having said that, I am upset, not about the boycotts because they're not happening, about the degree of hostility toward Israel. And I distinguish between hostility toward Israel and sympathy for the Palestinians. You can be sympathetic when it takes you 2 hours instead of 15 minutes because of roadblocks to get to the hospital or whatever. But the worst human rights abuses in the world are not happening in the West Bank. They're just not. Not even the second or third or fourth worst. And the level of hostility that people on campus, kids, are displaying scares me. Almost every Jewish kid in America goes to college, and most of them go to about 500 particular high-level selective colleges, which is where the anti-Israel sentiment is highest. These kids go to college unprepared, Jewish. I mean, it's standard in America. People get a PhD in world studies, and they drop out of Jewish at age 13. So they don't know anything. And when they hear these arguments, Israel did this, Israel did that, the Palestinians, they don't know what to say. And by and large, nobody wants to be unpopular. That's the hip thing going on. Most of them do tend to be liberal. which I don't object to, so they back away. And we're losing a generation of Jewish kids. Let me go one step further. Since the 70s, really, there has been a rise in the number of non-Orthodox Jews who marry non-Jews. In the famous 1990 survey that was conducted by the Jewish Federations, they found that it reached 52% of Jews who marry in a given year marry non-Jews, 48% marry Jews. I think it was a bit exaggerated, but it's continued to rise. You now have something like 70% in any given year. Not 70% are intermarried, but those who marry in any given year marry non-Jews.
Which what was Pew showed.
What was wrong was that they predicted, the survey asked intermarried couples in 1990, are you raising your children Jewish, Christian, or neither, or both? And 28% said Jewish. When you now interview adult children of intermarriage, 60 to 65% say, I'm Jewish, which means that the parents who didn't want their kids to be Jewish, something went wrong for them. Because the being Jewish is hip, it's John Stewart, it's Henry Kissinger, it's Barbara Streisand, it's Woody Allen, you go on and on. Being Jewish is high status in America. And so people who grow up in mixed homes, if they're asked to choose between which of their grandparents they identify with more closely on this issue, the majority choose being Jewish. Will that happen in 15 years after these kids that are in college grow up? When their kids go to college and the college is hostile to Jews, hostile to the Jewish state, how will those children with one Jewish parent feel about choosing the Jewish side of their identity? That scares me more than anything. Israel can take care of itself.
I agree with almost everything JJ said, except no Islamic terrorism, no checkpoints, no two-hour waits, no Islamic terrorism, no checkpoints at our United States airports and airports around the world. It is Arab terrorism that forces those checkpoints. Israel doesn't want them. We don't want checkpoints in airports. We have to protect ourselves from Islamic terrorism.
I didn't say there shouldn't be checkpoints. I said that it makes life more difficult for the Palestinians.
Well, you said that you understand why liberal kids would be sympathetic.
That's what they hear.
Yes.
It's not covered.
But what isn't said is why the checkpoints exist.
Well, then the other thing that isn't said is what the military and intelligence community says should be done about it, which is we can defend. Dan Chalutz, who was the chief of staff, he had appointed chief of staff of the IDF by Sharon. He was one of the most openly hawkish people who had ever been the chief of staff. In 2010, he joined the Kadima party, Ehud Olmert's party. And reporters, as he left the office after signing the card, said, why did you join Kadima? And Chalutz said, I think it's one of the most important things any public figure in Israel has said in years, any border that the political echelon in Israel chooses is a border that the IDF can defend. Any border. Almost. Israel's not being asked to go to the 1947 borders. It's being asked to go to the 1949 borders with adjustments. And the Army's consulting, and the vast majority, there's about 500 ex-generals, currently living retired generals in Israel. 260 of them have signed a statement saying that Israel should now accept the Arab Peace Initiative, negotiate over the fate of the refugees, and agree to a border based on the 67 borders. 260. How many have come out against it? About a dozen.
Okay.
And they also supported the Gaza withdrawal. They supported the Oslo Agreement, and they were dead wrong about most of these similar generals.
So I guess that's why Israel has been losing every war since 1949, because the army doesn't know what it's doing.
Wrong about the positions they've taken about these agreements with Israel, with the Palestinian Authority.
Okay, so you're the Israeli here.
So I'll tell you, the BDS, JJ, is not an economic threat to Israel. It's an existential one. It's a political problem. The BDS supporters, they want to drive a wedge here in the United States between the American people and Israel. So in a generation or less, America will be like Europe. And what the Palestinians are doing is very much an orchestrated campaign, well-organized, well-financed, well-thought-out, and it replicates their experience in Europe. In Europe, 30, 40 years ago, the Europeans were, you know, fellow democracy like Israel. They sympathized with us. The Palestinians, in a very deliberate, systematic way, vilified Israel. So, and again in Europe, and we didn't pay attention. We thought, well, if there is some esoteric organization here, some union labor in Brussels or some organization academic here are boycotting Israel, that's okay, we'll go away. We'll just lay low. We will not dignify them even with a response, and this will go away. Not at all. It's like the Goebbels propaganda philosophy. If you repeat a lie enough times, it becomes the truth. Today, we have lost Europe. It became the mainstream. You know, there was a big public opinion poll that was taken in Europe a few years ago, and 26,000 Europeans from the EU were asked to rank countries according to their, you know, liking. Israel came out number 4 from the bottom. The only three that were less favorable than us were North Korea, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. Iran was higher than us. Why is it? Because of the Palestinian effort. Now, they were very encouraged with what happened in Europe, so they're trying to do this here. And if we are not careful, it may happen very easy. And it will not take 30 or 40 years because of social media. It may take much lesser. So when I hear all of a sudden about the Presbyterian Church trying to boycott Israel, and then I hear about the American studies professors boycott Israel or campus here or there, we must connect the dots. It's not coming out of thin air. It's coming because of Palestinian pressure and work. And if we are not careful enough, it may become the mainstream. And this is why we have to level the playing fields for Israel in the social media, in campuses, in the education system, everywhere, in the culture. I mean, I see sometimes some, you know, Hollywood series where you see, you know, in the movies how Israel is being vilified and how the Palestinian terrorists are being glorified.
It's both happening now in Homeland.
Absolutely.
Also.
Yeah, it's really amazing.
Also, it is amazing. Yeah, it is amazing. Where very, were the times that we were, you know, the Exodus time, you know, Leon Uris and all that? Anyway, this is why I'm really concerned. This is why the truth about Israel
very
came about.
Very important. Very important. What you're doing.
Show the Democrats.
33% of Democrats support Israel over the Arabs. 33% support the Palestinian Arabs over Israel. Thank God the Republicans, 74-11 for Israel. But 20 years ago, the Democrats were overwhelmingly supportive of Israel. We've never had these kind of types of numbers in the past. It's really, it's really is something to be concerned about. I agree with the ambassador.
Okay, you get to wrap it up. As you hear all this, what are your thoughts here?
Well, a few things. JJ challenged Mort a moment ago when he said, well, you know, the generals know so little, how come they keep winning all these wars? Well, that, JJ, is the point. The Arab states are horrendous at fighting wars against Israel. They're never going to beat Israel in a war. That's exactly right. The BDS movement is a movement that acknowledges we are not going to beat Israel in a war, no matter what. But we can poison minds. We can poison a generation. People are ignorant. They don't know anything. We're living in an anti, by the way, President Obama helped in this way, a very anti-colonialist time. White people are on the run. If you're a white person on this planet, you're not in the favored category, especially among writers, among intellectuals, on university campuses. We have a very strong anti-colonial impulses. And Israel, by the way, even the attempts to show that Jews have no connection to historic biblical Israel is an attempt to say, you are an oppressor. You are a white colonialist. You are not indigenous to Israel, which is just absurd, right? But you're dealing with widespread global ignorance, and you're dealing with this kind of presumption that, you know, the Western culture is always to blame for what happens to oppressed people. So that's really this, you know, welcome to my world, Mark. This is what it's like on campuses. This is what it's like on newspapers and magazines. I mean, it's a lot, let me just say, it's a lot easier to be J.J. Goldberg than to be Thane Rosenbaum. It just is to be a writer on the left who, in J.J. would say, he takes more nuanced positions. I might say something else about that, but the reality is, to be pro-Israel is not a very popular thing. It is not fashionable on campuses. It's not fashionable among intellectuals. And on campuses, the BDS movement is a problem because it does, in fact, poison and contaminate minds. And that is a war that might be winnable. And I think what Danny said is correct, that Europe is an example of one frontier that was lost. Part of the problem is that when I was at Berkeley a few weeks ago, and this, I'll wrap this up, there, the woman who was most angry at me, I learned later, was Jewish. She had purple hair. I learned later her father was Israeli, right? At one point, she screamed from the audience, and the Israelis have all this land. They have all this land. And I really couldn't even respond. I went, what? Like, I just thought, this is Berkeley. This is a major university. What kind of a bonehead are you? That's your comeback? All this land. There is an astonishing amount of moral narcissism on the left, and even among Jews. Hey, guess what? Especially among Jews. It's very fashionable to say the following. I wrote about this for the Times of Israel, to say the following. Oh, look at me. I used to love Israel. I've traveled to Israel. I planted a tree. I have a pioneer hat. But I can no longer love Israel because of its behavior towards the Palestinians. I have to remove myself from you, O Israel, because you are now morally suspect, and I need to remain morally pure. These people do not ask questions about the Arab world. They don't ask the question that Mort's asking about Islamic extremism, terrorism. They simply say, I want to judge Israel more harshly. It's much more fashionable to say this on a dinner party on the Upper West Side, and there are places, Reform synagogues all over the country, where this plays well. And on university campuses, it's the best. It is just perfect for a Jewish kid to say, oh, look at me. I'm an Israel basher. I'm critical of my people. I find it morally vulgar what Israel does to the poor, poor Palestinians. Instead of asking, how did the poor Palestinians become the poor, poor Palestinians? And why so reflexively sympathetic? Why not ask, why isn't it that Israel, what it has to do is something it doesn't want to do, but may be necessary for its own for survival, and why the Palestinians do not have to live in refugee camps? They could have been building a nation all this time, but they're choosing a different path, and a morally and politically ruinous path, but it's not something that Western liberals should be supporting.
There you have it. Mort Klein, J.J. Goldberg, Ambassador Danny Ayalon, Thane Rosenbaum. Thane said it nicely, but the truth is, it's not about JBS, it's about who these people are. The lovely thing about JBS is we get to bring them to you. This is not normal discussion that you'd hear typically anywhere else, so I'm very, very proud to be able to bring them to you. And I say to you again, please, if you have any comments at all for any of the things that JJ or Mort or Danny or Thane have said, please email me, write me, post on our Facebook page, or tweet me. I look forward to hearing from many of you. Until the next time, I'm Mark Golub. L'chaim, my friends, to life.
Pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.